So, I mean, maybe all these are to some extent predictable. But what I tried to do in my articles and what I will still be doing in my, my book, I will try to put all these into a global shift perspective. Apart from my students, probably you are not completely aware what I am talking about. What does global shift perspective mean? It is somewhat related to the historical analysis of the economies, countries' positioning in the world. But there is always my first premise, my first explanation in order to explain your global shift perspective is there is always one world system. So nothing economically remains outside of the system. So whatever happens in this world, wherever in this world, was in this one single world system. And but within this world system, all the economies, countries, multinationals, they all occupy different positions. And these positions determine the level of power, the level of influence they exercise in the world economy. So in simple terms, at the very center, the core economies, the most powerful, the strongest economies, or one major economy or empire, always is at the in this core level, and most of the events, most of the structures, most of the policies being affected by this core. And around this core, there are other economic powers. They are, I call this semi-core. And around this, there is semi-periphery, and at the very outside, it is the periphery. Most of the weakest, poorest economies are located here. And the richest ones are located here, and all the others are located accordingly. This is a historical structure. But of course, this structure never remains the same. But of course, once a group of countries, economies, became the core economies, they stay in that position for a reasonably long period of time. But after a while, as a result of competition from the others, they couldn't remain in that position, and they decline, and some others come and move this position. And this position also called hegemonic position. So they are the hegemonic powers. They determine, they decide almost everything important in the world, sometimes in coordination with others, or sometimes not. So the change in this hegemonic position I call global shift. And global shift happened several times in the world history. It doesn't happen too often, but it happens like once a century, or most of the times once in two or three centuries. Once in a while, it was China and India, the core economies, trading everyone, producing everyone, and determining all the conditions of trade and production in the world. And around 18th century, European colonial powers, they replaced China and India. China and India declined in economic strength, in political strength, and first Dutch Empire played this role, and then British Empire was the hegemonic power. And around the turn of the century, 19th to 20th century, the United States started to challenge the British Empire. And probably from around the Second World War onwards, officially the United States became the major core power. So now, currently, what I'm saying is, in according to this picture, another global shift is happening. And what was happening the last 10, 15, 20 years, and what recently emerged as the global financial crisis and economic downturn, these were all the consequence of this global shift. Or in a way, I use another term, global fault lines, referring to almost earthquake kind of movements among the fault lines. And when the fault lines come and push each other, and there were sudden changes like earthquakes. And 2007-08 crisis was something like that. So in this global shift picture, if I put all what I told before about North Africa and Middle East, if I put them in that context, what does it mean? This global shift picture has a very important demographic dimension. So demography plays a very important role, because when used effectively, a country's population, large population, young population, is probably the most significant ingredient for any kind of economic progress, more than anything else, more than any other resource, even more important than oil. And this is exactly what is happening now. As I said, from late 1970s onwards, a large population increase happened in the world. And especially those countries which can be considered in the global south, the previously underdeveloped countries, another term, developing countries, they experience this population increase more than the rest of the world. Like China, India, Latin American countries, African countries. And in this context, the share of increase, population explosion happened in MENA countries is exemplary, as I said earlier. I mean, they experienced the largest share of population explosion, and this affected the whole composition of their population. So, and this population explosion was one major ingredient of the global shift. This was one of the essential ingredients which pushed those countries, China, India, Brazil, Indonesia, Malaysia, to play this important role, to challenge the existing global hegemonic economic powers and to rise in importance to the global significance. So the same demographic factor affected MENA countries to change the whole population composition, to bring the young people, young population, to play a major role in the country, in the future of country. But in the whole global south, those countries with much more flexible economies, much more established and dynamic economies, they managed to use this population effectively. And they benefited from that, as we are witnessing now in those mainly BRIC countries, and but the others like Indonesia, Malaysia, South Korea, South Africa, Nigeria. But those other countries, with, their economies was either too weak or too one-dimensional, as in these cases, they tried by introducing neoliberal measures very quickly. But of course, these neoliberal measures brought their end much quicker, because they didn't bring essential benefits like providing jobs and providing increasing the production in the country. And in most of the cases, the money was used just to invite some international tourism corporations or some oil corporations to come and get some more shares from the country. It didn't basically help the local population, and maybe just a small group of elite benefited from this within the country. So in this sense, this Arab Spring chaos is kind of result of the global shift, the population explosion part of the global shift. So this is basically my argument.